So you noticed a small age spot that's getting bigger or darker in color. Maybe it's changing its appearance. Maybe you're noticing a yellowish tinge to it. So how do you know if that's actually an age spot or skin cancer? So today we'll be actually talking about the different types of age spots that you may be seeing and how to determine if it's actually an age spot to go ahead and treat it as if it was an age spot versus skin cancer. Hi, my name is Christy and I'm the owner of Go See Christy Beauty Boutique located in Southern California, and I have been treating clients with hyperpigmentation, acne, and other skin conditions for over 11 years. And we are going to be talking about the different types of age spots. So the first one is more common. It's the age spot, otherwise known as a liver spot. It could be called solar lentigines or senile lentigo. So this is more common in adults over 50, although younger people can get them as well. And it's more common in areas where the sun gets regular exposure to the skin. So this could be on the face, the hands, the arms, the shoulders, and the back. And it is more common in lighter skinned people. So just imagine an age spot. The common appearance of this is flat. So there's no surface to it. It's just a flat circle, and it could be small to medium. So it could range from very small all the way to a half inch in diameter. The color can range from tan, brown, and or black, and it can start to actually even group together. So the causes of this is overactive and irregular pigmentation. You don't need any medical attention for this one. This is not harmful. The main cause of this, or can be, is continual sun exposure or continual use of tanning beds. So what this is usually is, by the time you see the hyperpigmentation up on the stratum corneum, which is the top layer of the skin, most people think it's just the darkening on the skin, but actually the hyperpigmentation starts lower, deeper in the skin cells. So the hyperpigment starts in the melanocytes, and every layer that goes up until the top layer is actually pigmented. So although these are one of the easier ones to treat, minus if it's not melasma, is that by the time someone sees it on the stratum corneum, it's more difficult to treat because they have to not only treat it from the top layer, they also have to treat it from where the source came from. So a lot of times when my clients come in for a facial and they go under a machine, it actually shows them what's going on underneath the skin. And sometimes they will ask me, why do I have all this freckling or brown patches underneath, but they don't see it on the top? And that's because that hyperpigmentation has already formed underneath and is working its way up the skin. So typically, if someone has that, it is better to start treating that hyperpigmentation even before it reaches the top layer of the skin, because it is a lot easier to treat than once it hits the top layer of the skin, because now every time sun gets exposed to it, it can get darker. And there'll be more details on how on the different treatments for this. So the next one is called a macule. A macule is basically, it's flat. It doesn't have any type of surface on it. It's usually less than 1 centimeter, and it's usually just brown. And it's typically like a freckle. And I'll be showing you one that I have on the back of my leg. And you can usually treat this with cryotherapy, which is using liquid nitrogen or carbon dioxide that is frozen down to, the temperature is down to minus 79 or minus 59, depending on what you use, to go ahead and freeze that, and it's not painful. So that's one of the easier ways to treat that.
Okay, so I'm going to go focus in the center. This one is kind of big, so it's probably going to need a few treatments, but I'm going to start off and so I can show you. So this is my own leg. Here we go. And then we just leave it and avoid sun exposure.
And macules, anyone can have this. Anyone of any type of age can have this. And it is fairly common. So the next one is seborrheic keratosis, also known as senile warts. And unlike the macules, these are actually related to aging. It's also nicknamed, also known as the barnacles of aging. So the numbers of these can actually increase with age, especially 50 and over. They are benign, and instead, unlike a macule that's a flat surface and not indented and it's smooth, these are just like, it can look like barnacles. They're kind of they can be rough, it's irregular, it can be indented. Sometimes they'll have like a waxy look to them or kind of a yellowish brown to them, and it can range in colors from brown to dark brown to black. Even so, they can be scaly or kind of bumpy, so and they can actually even be itchy. They can run in families as well. Now, these are caused by keratinocytes. So those keratinocytes are basically cells that create keratin, and again, it can run in families, and they're usually found again in areas where there's regular sun exposure, although it doesn't have to be, on the face, on the hands, arms, shoulders, the back, even and common in the trunk areas, and even on the scalp. So this can be treated. This one has to be a little bit more invasive. So this can be cryotherapy or cryosurgery, where they're freezing it off. They can do laser surgery, ablation. They can do surgery and just remove it. So this is something that they have to use a little bit more invasive procedure, in which you do have to go see a doctor to do. And they can be burned off as well. Now, this one can sometimes be mistaken for actinic keratosis, which we'll talk about, which typically are precancerous cells, and depending on the appearance of it. So I did a video on the ABCDEs, the five signs of skin cancer, to compare to see if it could be precancerous. But So it's not. A lot of times it can be mistaken for actinic keratosis. So this leads into my next one, which is actinic keratosis, also known as solar keratosis. And it is typically red, scaly. It could be bumpy, it could be itchy and flaky, and it could be hard like a wart, and it's typically red to reddish brown. It is more common in fair skin individuals. And it's usually found on areas, again, where there's regular sun exposure. So that could be on the face, the nose, the lips. For men, it's very common on the scalp if they have no hair, as well as the ears. So it sometimes has this like yellowish white crustiness, where it looks like dead skin or just like scabby. So that is actinic keratosis. And usually you want to get that looked at, because it can turn precancerous. So these are the people who are more likely to develop it, and these are your Fitzpatrick scale number one. So if you are not familiar with that, please go ahead and look at the video beforehand, where I describe specifically the different Fitzpatrick scale and the types. So Fitzpatrick skin type one, these are your people who have naturally light blonde hair, fair skin, light blue eyes, light gray, light green eyes, cannot tan, always burns. It can run in families, and it's typically due to overexposure of the sun. It can be due to a weakened immune system, and this is usually brought on by repeated intense sunburns or sun exposure. And it's typically in areas where most of the year it's very sunny or the sun is very strong. Now, if caught early, they can actually remove it before it becomes precancerous or cancerous. And the best way to avoid this is to avoid sun exposure. And the reason why I'm including this is, so many times I've had clients come in where they thought it was an age spot that just kept flaking. And I told them, you may want to go look at that. And a handful, over the course of years, I think five of them where I suggested they go see a doctor, it actually was precancerous or it actually was cancerous. So I am including this because some people mistake it for an age spot that keeps flaking. So if you've been watching our hyperpigmentation videos, now you guys know where you fall under the Fitzpatrick scale. So if you don't know, go ahead and watch that video, and how your skin may respond to the hyperpigmentation, what types, whether it was internally or externally caused. Now we can actually start talking about the different treatments for hyperpigmentation. So that's coming. And remember, makeup is an art and skincare is a science. And if you haven't watched it, we'll go ahead and include it into our playlist.